All right, here we go. 3, 2, 1. Ladies and gentlemen, it's my distinct pleasure to introduce you and introduce this session of the Extraordinary Technology Conference 2014. I'd like to introduce you to Suzanne Price. She holds a bachelor's and master's degree in cultural anthropologies. She has studied, or she has talked here before on quasar physics, which is the integration of our connection to spirit and science. So she's going to be speaking today about ancient technologies. Did they have zero-point energy? Did they understand it? And how we can learn from their example to explore zero-point energy today. So I'd like you to give a warm welcome to Suzanne Price.
Good morning, everybody. It's great to be here at this wonderful conference. I would like to give a special acknowledgement to the young people who have come here to our conference. After all, you folks are our future, and we do need to expend some effort in fostering and working with them so they understand where we're at and where we're going. It's going to be in your hands. Well, a lot of you have probably heard about the WebBot. And all of the phrases are collected on the web. What are people talking about and what are the trends? So, you know, as I've been sitting listening to some of the sessions, and I've been finding that a lot of what you've been talking about, some of it is incorporated in my talk today. And I picked up a few phrases. I'm going to call this the Tesla Tech Bot. And at the end of my talk, I am going to compare some of the trends that I've seen here at this conference compared to the last one. But I'm going to start out with this one. Anomalies violate the paradigm. And in my talk, I'm going to show you a lot of anomalies, just like all of you are working with. Another, anomalies will launch the next paradigm shift. And I certainly think that is true. And finally, just for starters, ZPE is the basis of the paradigm war. And we certainly are in one, but I think we're making great progress. Now, got to get my equipment here together. I selected the Sphinx as my opening symbol. I think it's an important one. An important symbol of the mystery and the paradigm shift. You all remember the old riddle of the Sphinx, right? What walks on four legs in the morning, two in the afternoon, and three at night? That's man, of course. We know the answer to that one. But on a deeper level, I think it's about cycles. And I think paradigm shift is about the changes in the cycle as well. And I'm going to be talking about that. So let's get going. This year, I asked myself three questions. Did ancient civilizations know about and utilize zero-point energy technology? And if so, what is the evidence? I primarily have looked at the Indus Valley, Samaria, and the pre-dynastic Egypt, and that's before the time of the pharaohs. Also, I know there's evidence out there in Peru and perhaps a few other places, but I focused on those specifically. And then finally, what can we learn from the evidence to enhance our current research and projects? And I found some answers to share with you that I'm kind of excited about. First one, have there been prior highly advanced technological civilizations equal to our own, and how long ago? First, just a word about dating. It can be flaky. There can be conditions that change it, but there's nowadays, there's a lot more dating methods that we have to work with. The typical ones are carbon-14, potassium, argon, and the like. But it's become sophisticated, and we've been able to fill in the gaps where we have materials to work with. Usually what happens is they're measuring the half-life of the object in question, such as a piece of wood, something in ceramics, and the like. And they just take the ratio. How long does it take for it to decay? And then they measure that. First, we'll start out with the Giza Plateau. in the 1880s, this is what it looked like. Now, the Giza Plateau is part of the Sahara Desert. It's on the eastern, no, yeah, the western side of the Sahara Desert. Not, well, it's actually on the edge of the Cairo suburbs. And this is what it looked like. You can get a perspective of it here by the folks. See how tiny they are? This is a huge thing. Also, I do want to point out to you, look at the feet here. Perhaps it's hard to see from where you are, but these are little tiles that are put together. It's not just one piece of sandstone. This is interesting, tightly packed together. Maybe they've been, you know, repaired in the past. Also, down here, you see the tiles. And they look pretty uniform, don't they? Today, it's been completely dug out, of course. They've been working on this for over a century plus. And how this looks, first of all, how many people have been to the pyramids and seen the Sphinx and stuff? Just a couple of you. How many have been inside the pyramid? Just a couple of you. So you'll be able to relate to some of these images a little bit more and maybe verify what I'm saying. This is huge, and it's very old. I mean, now they're saying it's about 12 to 15 years ago that this thing was constructed. It's constructed of dolomite limestone. And then these, I think, were added on or reinforced down here. You see the tiles, the different colors? There you go. The tails, same thing. And above, we've got a little harder limestone. But anyway, 12,000 to 15,000 years ago is a lot older than what they thought. Okay. There's a gentleman by the name of Robert Shook, who is a geologist and geophysicist. He has a theory called the water erosion hypothesis, and this is how they figured it out. If you look here, some of the erosion patterns, it's not made by the wind, all right? And they've been able to date this back to the time up here, 10 to 12,000 years ago, this erosion was happening. And then it was later, when the site was abandoned, the sand started to come in, and they've dug it all out. And here they're doing some repair work. So that's pretty interesting. And his hypothesis has been verified by other investigators as well, including John Anthony West, who is a paleoclimatologist. Now I'm going to look at a couple other sites. I'm going to go through this kind of quickly because I want to get to the meat of the matter. I've got a really great example to share with you. This one is Göbekli Tepe in southeastern Anatolia in Turkey. It's been dated at about 12,000 years ago. And what they have found are about 20 circles, 200 pillars in 20 circles of these really tall pillars that you see here, and they have carvings on them. There's nothing else there. There's no evidence of animal husbandry or any kind of agricultural activities whatsoever. These pillars, right here you see one, are about 20 to 30 feet tall, and they're embedded in a carved out spot at the bottom where they're fitted into hard rock. And here you see an example of the circles. And some of the very interesting animals that are carved on there, animals that haven't been there for a very long time. This is now semi-desert. These animals are more of a forest dweller type species. Another example, some of you may have seen these, maybe some of you haven't. It's called Puma Punko, and this is near Teotihuacan in Bolivia, also dated approximately 12,500 years. Now what's interesting about this is that you see these huge flattened blocks with very sharp edges, all right? How did they do that long ago? And also, how did they bring these blocks up from their quarrying spot, which is about 60 miles away, and they had to haul them up a mountain? Nobody knows. These big ones weigh about 100 tons apiece. How did they do that? There was no trees. This is all above the tree line, so that's not an option. Maybe they had some other way of doing it. But they have perfectly smooth, flat surfaces and perfect right angles to them. Here's a picture of some of the I guess you'd call them, whoops, go back. Inlay work here, pretty precise. This is Klaus Donna at the Sun Gate. He and a gentleman by the name of Michael Cremo have done a lot to bring information to our attention about ancient civilizations. I think it's information that's been somewhat suppressed, but it's now coming out more and more. By the way, this site at Pumapunco is very near Teotihuacan, which is what was once a center of an urban civilization. And one of the interesting things that they found there was something called the Fuente Magna ceramic bowl, which had on it Sumerian cuneiform and Proto-Sumerian hieroglyphics on it, which suggests that there was great communication between the old world and the new world as far back as 12,500 years ago. And here we see more examples of this intricate machining that now we can barely reproduce, if at all, and probably, we speculate, was done with ultrasonics. I've had machinists and others look at these here. They probably had metal brackets. Look at this, and they're interlocking. This is very precise. How'd they do that way back then? And what was this site for? Another one that's kind of interesting that you may not know about. This is called the Lady of Mali. It's in West Africa. The monument is carved in granite, and it's 150 meters from top to bottom. Here you see the face. It's dated at about 12,000 years ago, maybe older than that, because they estimate it as part of a greater civilization next door in Sierra Leone, which was dated at 12,500 to 35,000 years ago. And, interestingly enough, this face is not what you would call a typical African face. It's more Caucasian. Another site is... Actually, this is an error because I was a good kid and I turned in my presentation 3 weeks before and I kept going and so I found my own mistakes, okay? This is actually in the Punjab of Pakistan. And here, this particular site, there's two of them I'm going to talk about. Here's Harappa and here's Mohenjo-Daro, which are along the Indus Valley River. And Harappa is a wonderful site. It was... discovered in 1923 when an urban area was expanding, but they noticed that people in and around the... Well, not this one. I'm wrong about that. What I want to tell you about this is that it is a very sophisticated layout. It's probably one of the first urban planning sites that we know about, as you can see. Here we probably have a public bath. They had streets, square houses, the whole nine yards. We know that they had a very sophisticated water and wastewater system that predates the Minoan civilization on the island of Crete. They had a very diversified social and economic system as well. And they also had a writing system which is undeciphered and is earlier than those in Mesopotamia and Egypt. The second one that I wanted to talk about is Mohenjo-Daro. Now, when I was a graduate student, this was all the curiosity. It was a great anomaly. Okay, why? This is the one they found as a result of too many people getting cancers and other ailments in the immediate area. And they figured out it was radiation, so they went hunting, okay? And they found this site, Mohenjo-Daro. What is unique about it? If you look at this very carefully, it's very clean looking. Why? Vitrified glass. There's only a few ways that could happen. And what they speculate is that there was an atomic explosion, particularly since they have also found a number of skeletons that just sort of fell as they died. And so that has been a real curiosity in the world of archaeology, let me tell you. Now, we know that the Indus Valley peoples are very, very ancient, maybe as old as 18,000 years ago. We know this from their texts, the Rig Veda, the Bhagavad Gita, the Mahabharata, and other works. It was passed down orally until it was finally written down between the 7th and 4th centuries BC. It is a huge, huge collection of all kinds of materials, from hymns to discourses on science. And the Samkhya cosmology is one of the six Hindu systems derived from all of this. It's in the Advaita Vedanta Yoga, which parallels modern physics. They have a theory of atomics called Vaivasika, and also Samkhya, which is a knowledge or science. And within this, they outlined a very detailed description of atoms, which they called param-anus. Now, anu is their term for the quanta, the building block of life, and that we know as the infinity symbol. They said, for example, there's six kinds of quarks, six kinds of antiquarks, leptons, and the like. They describe it in very detail, but in a different language, of course, these particles. And so what I wanted to show you is that it does, in fact, parallel the modern particle chart. Here you've got six quarks and six leptons, just to give you an example and not go into it too deeply. They even have descriptions of flying machines, or vimanas. A lot of you are familiar with that. What got me when I looked this up is, look at this. There's different kinds. Tripura vimana, Rukma vimana, Shakuna vimana, and they have descriptions of these in there. So they had this kind of technology. I find it really amazing. It has proved to be an inspiration to modern civilization to try and duplicate this and learn from it. Now, I mentioned this in one of my earlier talks. I believe it was the first one I gave on qualer physics. I want to just mention to you that a gentleman by the name of Swami Vivekananda, who was an Advaita Vedanta teaching master at the turn of the 20th century, he traveled to the United States, and one of his purposes was to connect up with the leading scientists of the day, because he wanted to show them and prove that what was in the teachings of Advaita Vedanta were parallel to those of modern science of the day. And so he contacted Nikola Tesla, Walter Russell, and Lord Kelvin. And I do believe that Tesla was very interested in these teachings and studied with him. We don't have a lot of records about this, except that they made a connection. Now, one of my most favorite things, which are anomalies, and I love anomalies, that's probably how I got started in anthropology years ago, is called OOP art, out-of-place artifacts. So I want to show you a few of these just to demonstrate just how old some of these civilizations were and how sophisticated they could have been. Above, we see a mechanical device in volcanic rock dated 400 million years ago. Some of these are going to blow your mind. Oops, forgot the other one. On this, below there on the side, we have an unusual aluminum alloyed metal piece found in coal. Vladivostok, I hope I pronounced that right, Russia, 300 million years old. This is one of my favorites. This is a whistle that was found in an excavation in Sierra Leone, dated at 17,000 years ago. And they x-rayed it and did some stuff, and they found out there was something inside here. That's why it was a whistle. And when they analyzed what it was, chrome steel. How did they know about that way back then? Where'd they get that? Here's one, an iron pot found in 1921 in Oklahoma in a coal seam dated 314 million years ago. Most of these are found in coal seams, which can be dated. And here, down below, an aluminum assembly. They don't know what the alloy is. Found in Romania, dates between 145 and 200 million years ago. Someone was speculating that was part of a stabilizer of a spacecraft because of the way it was formed, but who knows. This is one of my all-time favorites. Found in 1851, a zinc silver encrusted vase with vine designs found in a block of coal in the States dated 534 million years ago. How did they get there? Was it a civilization on the planet? Was it a civilization so advanced that they came to the planet? Or a civilization that had the ability to time track and left something behind? We really don't know. But these are anomalies that get our spirit of curiosity really cranked. Now, not only is civilization probably not linear, as many believe, but that also applies to human evolution. And I'm just going to give you a couple little examples just because. These are pictures of elongated skulls recently discovered near Nazca, Peru. These are called the Paracas skulls. Look at these guys. Some of them are redheaded. They actually still have the hair on them. This is in southern Peru. All right. And here's the features. What's interesting is these heads are not deformed. You know, sometimes they had the custom of wrapping the head. And you see that. But this does not follow the pattern. They had one parietal lobe rather than two, which is what we've got. And their teeth were different, and their jaws were prominent. They had much longer femur bones. So that was a fascinating one to me. And then also, I just want to point out, throughout the world, they have found giant skeletons everywhere. Now, this has been suppressed. There have been hoaxes out there. But it's well documented, and I have a reason for including these. I do, however, want to point out, as I continued my research after I put this together and turned it in, these two photos are actually fakes. Why? They had a contest. Who could make the greatest fake out there? And these two I discovered were in there. And I was disappointed because I thought I was really clever. You know, I thought, look at these shadows. How could they fake this? You know? But somehow they were managed to do that. Who knows? Now I want to go on to the really meaty stuff. What is the evidence out there? Did they discover zero point and utilize it? So let's look further. First, I want to point out a slide you've already seen before, which is one of our little Tesla Tech bots, right? If you wish to understand the universe, think of energy, frequency, and vibration. That one we've heard several times here today. And that one is perfectly pertinent. Now, I think also it could have as easily been said by John Warrell Keeley. And even Einstein is quoted as saying, everything is energy, and that's all there is to it. I like that one. Okay, we're going to go on to my example. Surprised? The Great Pyramid of Egypt. First of all, I will confess in my research, this is my second mistake. You know, I was looking for images that were pretty, you know. So this one came up when I Googled the Great Pyramid. It's actually the second pyramid, which is the Pyramid of Khafre. But the Great Pyramid looks exactly like this. They're twins, almost. But this one still has its limestone cap. The other one does not, and the other one does not have the top on it. That's disappeared a long time ago. You see, I believe there's very sufficient evidence that this Great Pyramid was not a tomb as has been touted for years and years, and it wasn't necessarily 40,000 slaves who hauled around, carved with crude implements and hauled around huge blocks of stone on rollers for 20 years. I don't really believe that. And this would probably raise the hackles of Zahi Hawass, who is the Secretary General of the Egyptian Supreme Council of Antiquities. I wanted to get his title correct. They continue to insist that it was a tomb of Khufu or Cheops, as we know him. Now, the Greek word for pyramid is pyramidus, which actually means, I mean, you could figure it out for yourself. It means fire from pyros, fire in the middle. This is a concept I'd like you to keep in mind. Even the ancient Kemetians, that's a name for the ancient culture of that region in pre-Pharaoh times, they called it Per-Neter, which means house of nature or house of energy. And I do believe that its purpose was to generate and transform and transmit energy. And as we shall see, I think this is really evident in the Queen's Chamber and the King's Chamber. Now, before we move on, I want to point out a couple of things. This thing is the real Great Pyramid, is about 481 feet tall, across 754 feet. You see the people down here. This thing is huge, probably built over maybe even centuries. It's hard to say. On the outside here, well, it used to be covered completely in this beautiful white Tura limestone, which doesn't have much magnesium in it, which makes it a beautiful insulator, important point. Underneath it, this thing covered another type of limestone called dolomite, which has a lot of calcium and magnesium in it, which means that it is highly conductive. At the top of it, it said that there was a cap of gold. I've also heard lapis, crystal, and ruby. Don't know for sure, but I am pretty certain it was some kind of conductive material. A few vital statistics, and I'm going to go through these kind of quickly because I want to show you what is going on inside of this pyramid. Located at the center of the Earth's energy grid, it has loads and loads of mathematical and harmonic codes in it, too many to even get started with. The Egyptians, of course, were very interested in astrology and astronomy, and I think they were quite intrigued with the precession of the equinoxes. They were most interested in the cycles. All right. One important thing to know is that the mathematical constants of pi and phi are found throughout it. And of course, all the mathematics in it predate Pythagoras and the Greeks. He probably got it from the mystery school of the Greeks, which came much later. It resonates with the Earth's resonance at 7.83 to 8.1. It does vary a little bit, which is an interesting point. And finally, I want to point out that it is built of 2.3 million limestone blocks. Most of them weigh 2 to 3 tons. Some of them are a lot more. And 20% of them consist of reaggregated limestone. Huh? What does that mean? That's right. Here's a controversy that challenges the paradigm that we've all lived with. A guy by the name of Joseph Davidovits, who's a chemical engineer and has lots of other degrees. He's with the Geopolymer Institute in Saint Quentin. I keep getting it mixed up. I want to say San Quentin, but that's not right. This is located in France, and he is considered the father of geopolymers. Okay, he proposed that, based on his analysis, which he started in the 1970s and carried it on, that some of these limestone blocks were actually cast, not carved, and that they were reconstituted, consisting basically of crushed, very finely crushed limestone with binders and a great deal more silicon dioxide, which would mean that they would be more conductive, right? And here, they would have been, that would have been done in the wadis, and here's the quarries. The wadis are right next door to the quarries. They would have been made right there and poured in situ, okay? And here we see the geology of the area. Here's the pyramid. There's a hard layer here of limestone, a softer one and a harder one. Here you see the Sphinx down at the bottom. So that's what he said. And he did electron microscope scanning and found these patterns to be quite unusual. They were amorphous. It wasn't natural at all. And that's how he came to that conclusion. Others have come on board, such as Michael Barsoom. And here's some examples. Look at this. These are carved. And even then, you wonder how they got them so close together. You know, some of these are 1/1000th of an inch. You can't stick a piece of paper in between them. Here's an example of what I think might have been cast. See how uniform they are in there? This looks like a little bit like a fallen cake or something. Maybe that one didn't quite gel right. I don't know. Here, Barsoom proposes that the inside of the pyramid was built with the regular limestone, and that on the edges, and then on the top, they use the reconstituted. So you've got insulative limestone, the Tula limestone, and inside you've got the dolomite and the reconstituted limestone. All for a purpose. Everything they did with precision and purpose. I'm going to be looking at a couple of investigators. Abdel Hakim, who's a wisdom keeper of the ancient Egyptian culture, and he passed his information on to Stephen Miller. Edward Kunkel and Stephen Myers, who believe that the machine of the pyramid was actually a water pump. John Cadman, who's come along more recently, he proposes that it's a sonic machine and a hydraulic pulse generator. He's working with the subterranean chamber, I'll show you. And I found that most fascinating because that was the missing piece. Nobody could figure out what it was. They all thought it was just an unfinished tomb down there 100 feet below this, the pyramid in the sandstone. Then we're going to look at a little bit at Chris Dunn, who also thought it was a sonic machine, but it was a hydrogen generator for the purpose of basically microwave signaling from inside. Nikola Tesla, I am basically, when I'm done with this, I'm going to compare what was done in the pyramid to the Wardenclyffe Tower of Tesla. Very interesting, because I think Tesla knew all about this somehow and used what we would call the pyramid effect. I'm also going to look at David Sirita, just a couple of slides. He proposes that it's a quantum harmonic oscillator, a giant crystal transducer. And I could not have made some of the interpretations that I have made without what I have learned from all of you here at Tesla Tech, as you will see. And there are many, many others that I have referenced or read about in preparing this. I believe that it's some kind of geomechanical negative ion pulse generator for the purpose of wireless electrical and communications energy. So let's see, is there enough evidence to make that claim? First, the indigenous teachings, which state, now he's the one that's carrying on the oral tradition of what's been passed down through the eons, basically. It was not intended as a tomb, we know that. Some type of sonic machine, he says. What he knows about is there is a chirping sounds came from it. And it was in existence before the time of the pharaohs, who merely modified, repaired, or maintained it. That hydrogen gas came from the subterranean chamber, and that there's a buried tunnel there that leads from the subterranean pit to the ancient Nile. And there was a mechanical element that opened and closed it. There are a lot of either basalt or granite plugs throughout the structure. It's said to be on the ley line. It's right there, a very important spot where there's a lot of telluric currents that stronger conductivity than other spots, although I have heard that that spot has moved, but I really don't have any information on it. And it's also very, very close to the continental plate, and that's one reason why they put it there. They wanted that plate under there. Going on. Let's see here. Whoops. And there you have it. It's considered to be right in the center of the planet. Here's an aerial view of it enhanced. This is the Great Pyramid, the Pyramid of Cheops or Khufu. This is the Pyramid of Khafre and Menkaure. These are individuals that came along later in the early pharaohic times. What you see here is urban sprawl. That looks like a golf course. Right there is the Sphinx, barely a dot on the map, right? This is a huge area here. And this used to be the old Ur Nile, and this used to be where the Nile went. The Nile is now 8 miles away from this spot. And here you see it, the Ur Nile. Here is where it was before. And the basic setup, there was a causeway that brought water from a moat. There was a moat around each one of these pyramids, and it brought excess water down here into the Nile. Here's the moat, what it looked like. This has been verified, but it's no longer there anymore. There is a structure here that looks like it might have been a water lock, and here's where the causeway was, right? So what happened here was, what has been proposed is that there was an ancient lake called Lake Moeris. It's about as big as Lake Erie was, and it gravity fed the water from there, channeled it over to where the moat was, okay? So the causeway took the excess water away, And this was constructed in order to maintain an equilibrium in pulsing that was going on. What? Pulsing? So here we've got an outer view, and I have not mentioned yet that right straight underneath there, along with the Nile, we've got an aquifer. So that's creating the movement of the water through the aquifer. The Nile is above it, of course. We've got negative ion generation going on in the sandstone. For the inner view here, we've got an apparatus that is mechanical. And just briefly, this is the subterranean chamber. This is the descending passageway where the water came in, where the moat was right there. An ascending passage, there was two tunnels, shafts that went this way, and I'll talk about them. And then a shaft that went on up here to the queen's chamber, and then there's a gallery, and then there's the king's chamber that are situated pretty much in the middle of the pyramid. And here we have a greater view of it. The subterranean chamber has been a mystery all along, as I have said. But now they're getting a much better handle on it. So what you've got here is you've got 100 feet from the pyramid down into the limestone, and it's all made of limestone, except for certain parts of it. There's plugs throughout. It's about 270 feet down here. I guess that's all we need to know for now. This little tunnel here is about 56 or 7 feet in until they found a plug or a granite plug. And down here they dug in the early days, 36 feet down. They covered it back up with some rubble. It's the tunnel that was a waste gate, I believe. So let's get into it. The two people I'm going to feature here are John Cadman on the right and Chris Dunn on the left. And these are the two principal investigators, I think, that are on the right track. John Cadman made a wonderful scale model of the subterranean chamber. I'm going to try not to confuse it too much. He made it to scale with 1 1/4 inch pipe. This little contraption, which was the chamber, I think was 5 by 8 by 15 inches. And he made several models. This is looking at it backwards, but this would be the descending passageway. This would be the upward shaft, which he called a check valve. This is the sort of dead end where there was another granite plug over here. And I'll explain how that worked. And then there was the wastegate, and then there was another outlet here. So I think this is the outlet for, he had to put it here to make this work. But he reconstructed the whole thing. In order to make it work, he made some modifications. And I think he did the right thing. He used a lot of logic. And he used quite a few models, several models. A few blew up while he was at it. So here's the descending passageway that we just looked at. And looking down here, you'll see that as it descends, it gets narrower. Let's look at that more closely. Okay, so it gets narrower. Here's the shaft that goes upward into the pyramid, and here's a plug. There's a kind of an antechamber here. And what happens is that the water is flowing from the moat that's been gravity-fed from the lake or the Nile down here, down this passageway. Then it gets narrower. And I'm told that it was Victor Schauberger who visited the Great Pyramid who got the inspiration for developing his vortexes, because that's what's going to happen in there. As it narrows, it's going to start spinning very violently, and John Cadman found that the dynamics inside the subterranean chamber, he called them tornadic. It was that violent. Okay, so here it's coming in, and this particular pit is 27 feet by 56 by 30. East to west, and I'll show you a better picture of this to visualize it. So it's coming in here. Here's where the dead end, or the, he's calling it a piston valve over here, a gate valve, and here's where the waste gate was. So it's coming in. It's kind of like a hydraulic ram pump. I had to learn all this stuff. I'm not into this really. So it would come in here. Here it is. Here's the output line, and here is the check valve, the standpipe. Here's what it looks like inside. This is a strange-looking thing, all limestone. So the water's coming in here. It's coming in. Let's look at it. This is looking at it from the top down, but this is a 3D view. The water's coming in here. and there's a pit in the floor, and then there's this upwardly raised, all these strange-looking fins. Nobody could figure out what that was. And then there's a smaller opening here that goes to the piston valve. I'll just call it a piston valve, okay? Now, when you look at this in a photo, it's backwards now. Here's where the water's coming in. You can see the man standing here. And then it's going across this way to another opening, right across from it, across the pit, the smaller opening where the man is sitting. All right? Then here's the pit that now goes down 18 feet or so. They put a, you know, something around it. And then up here, we've got the fins. Well, he made the model here of what he thought it would look like and what worked. And he put a glass over the top of this so he could do some ink studies. He did quite a few of these and took a lot of photographs. He was an expert in fluid dynamics and an engineer. All right. So he wanted to study the flow to see what he could learn from it. Well, the thing blew up. He had to actually make it out of epoxies, fiberglass, and reinforced steel in order to make this thing stay together because of the pressures and the activity inside. And here is an example of Edward Kunkel's pump. He called it the Pharaoh's pump. This was his first best guess, but he's missing a lot of things. He's missing the waste valve right here. But this is basically how it would have worked. You see the flow. And this is how the piston valve would have worked. Okay, so the water would have come rushing into the south of the smaller shaft, right? It would have been rushing down here because that angle of the descending shaft is pretty good. So it comes rushing down in a spiral, right? And it's going to hit this piston, a block of granite, really hard. And then some of the water is going to go out, and then it's going to create a rarefaction wave and a compression wave. Okay, so here you see it up here. Here's the one line, and then here's the waste shaft there. Okay, Cadman proposes that the whole reason for all this and all the activity going on here, and that activity is cavitation. And I believe the creation of hydrogen plasmoids, hydrogen and oxygen, the whole nine yards. We don't know, but it's a guess because it's interacting with the limestone. He says that when all of this was happening and it was going in all kinds of vortices and it was going down the pit, it was hitting an elbow, what does he call it? Reflective elbow in the shaft. And the purpose was to create compression. This compression, he says, at first there was compression when the water was hitting the small area across from where it was coming in the south side, I'll show you. And then it was coming back and all these very complicated turnings going on inside. Then it would hit down here, he proposes, because he doesn't know, but this is how he made it work. And he says compression waves, standing waves were going up this way into the Queen's Chamber and the King's Chamber. Let's see here, how am I doing on time? So he did some ink studies, and where did the water go? And here's the reflective elbow, why it had to be that to make the compression wave go up through the middle of the pyramid. And also, the pit had to be at a certain angle to make that happen, and that's exactly what he found. So he reconstructed all of this and he worked for 4 years from 1999 to 2003 on this stuff, experimenting with several models. So here's where the water would hit the south end, the smaller tunnel, and it would, the dynamics would spread this way. Then it's coming, see, here it's coming from the bigger tunnel to the smaller, and he calculated what the fluid dynamics would be. And then when it came back in, what they would be when they're swirling around this hole like this. Okay. So if it was creating, if it was cavitating plasma, hydrogen and oxygen and whatever, then what is happening to it? Maybe that's why the chamber was built up higher, which would not be the case with a hydraulic pump, all right? So he says, this is where the flow went. Up here to this end, which I believe is the northwest end. And there was a little indentation here, and there's a picture of where the indentation was. But of course, they haven't dug it out. Doing excavations within the pyramid is very difficult to do. So they haven't been able to get in there and verify this to a great degree. So the gas is swirling around on the ceiling, as you can see here, and then it's going out this way, but we don't know where it went. We're guessing. And he guessed that it was going up, that there was some sort of very small shaft, maybe 6 by 6 inches, going straight up to the Queen's Chamber, or it seems to me that it would have been a lot more efficient to go from here to the grotto. Oh, for sure? Oh, give or take. Okay, we're going to have to rush through this. Okay, thank you. Thank you. Okay, this is cold. So this is one of the unknowns. This is a guess based on his modeling. The gas had to go somewhere, but where did it go? We don't think it was going back up this way because there's just too much activity in that tunnel. All right, so did it go to the grotto? That was there's a little nodule up the shaft called the grotto, and he called this the shortcut for the shockwave to reach air to help regulate the pulse of the pump and so on. It was a sort of an efficiency thing, but I think, see this down here in this drawing, this old drawing? It is rubble down there. So I'm wondering if there wasn't a continuous shaft that went down there somehow. That's my guess, because I don't see that under the Queen's Chamber. All right. So this had a function. Here's a plug that was used, and he was finding that the efficiency by that plug being in there or not in there either reduced or enhanced it a great deal. And so he concluded that was not the purpose of this subterranean chamber in the grotto for efficiency at all. But he thought the main purpose was for the compression waves. So we go on. Now I'm going to take a look at Chris Dunn's work. He's been here before, but it's been many years. This is the inside. So we're now going to look at, we've looked at the subterranean chamber, the well shaft and the grotto here, and now it's going on up. This is an ascending area here. Maybe, I'm not sure what its function was for. Maybe for service, maybe for air to get in there, I don't know. The reaction chamber. Okay, some of you may know about him. I'm going to rush through this a bit. Okay. He called it a reactor device. And here I disagree with him. He says that the hydrogen, whatever form it was in, was reacted in this chamber. I wonder about that, and I think it might have been there or it might have been in the King's Chamber. We'll see. Anyway, what the characteristic of this is, that it was when it was first found, which the Arabs went in there in about 800 BC, I think it was, maybe it was AD. Sorry, can't tell you for sure. And when it was sealed up, and when they went in there, they were expecting to find mummies and treasures and this stuff, and instead they found Zippo. They found nothing but a little bit of rubble left over. It had been sealed up. One of the things noted, which has been cleaned up, is that this whole chamber, this is what it looks like, graphic form, was encrusted with an inch of salt. Okay, why? And what was the purpose of this chamber here, which goes back kind of far? Some people have speculated that it was a cooling tower. We don't know for sure. But we do know, based on what it looks like up here, there's some kind of explosion or fire that was up there. So I think fire was in this chamber, and I think it was somehow reacted in this chamber. There was a reaction of the hydrogen in this chamber. There was heat and pressure made that would have enhanced the conductivity of the piezoelectric quartz in all of the limestone and so forth. And there's two shafts, one here and one here. Now this is where Chris Dunn and I differ. He says, I think that there could have been a much more mechanical setup for creating hydrogen in the chamber and reacting it there. That came later. And the speculation is maybe the lake dried up, the source of water dried up, and they needed a more mechanical way of creating hydrogen in there. So they were exploring these two shafts. And here's one of the shafts with Erich von Däniken, right? And you can see the scale here. What they did in, I believe it was 1993, they created a little robot. This was Ralph Gattenbrink's. It was his name. He created this little robot, and I don't know how to pronounce this. It's German, so I'm just going to call it the little up and out. So they made this little robot guy go up the channel, and this is what they found. They found two metal rings that turned out, they think, to be copper. And there's a little hole over here where something could have, and it was just blocked, okay? So then that was in 1993. Then later on, they went in there again. Let's see, what year was that? Not remembering, but it was several years later, and they found stuff in there. They drilled a hole, and they put a camera through it, and this is what they saw behind where those metal rings were. Here's the other side of the rings, one of which has oxidation. So they thought maybe electrolysis, something electrical is going on in there. And then it was a square room back there, and they found evidence of workmen's drawings here and a little bit of debris, and then they found what looked like some helical windings that they speculated were cords. We really don't know. Maybe they were flexible conduit. We're really not sure. This is an artist's conception. Something electrical was going on, maybe dripping down that little hole into the chamber where it was reacted. And this is the conception. Now, what was going on there was a dilute hydraulic acid on one side and then a hydrated zinc solution on the other, which when together would react, creating the hydrogen, all right? And then it would also leave the salt incrustation. So, then what happens to the gas? Was it ignited in there? I don't know. Did it go back this way and into the gallery? Some people think that. Next, we go into the gallery area. This has been a mystery. It's 28 feet high. It has 27 rungs up the side, like here's the side view here, a ratcheted top. And so they're calling this a frequency tuning chamber. They really don't know. And Dunn hypothesized that what was across here, because they could have created these very easily, were Helmholtz resonators. These resonators are like if you ever held a Coke bottle or something and then you blew across the top of it and it made a sound. Well, that's like a Helmholtz resonator. And this is what they look like. And they could tune these. So it was a frequency tuner. That's what I think it was, too. There's no parallel structure like this, so we really don't know for sure. But it was perfect in every way. Its geometric design suggested that it was a tuning chamber. And it focuses the energy and the frequencies produced up into the chamber. And the upper part of it was lined with granite, and the lower part was in limestone. Okay. Other people have also speculated that this had a sort of a trolley, I don't know, block and tackle sort of arrangement to bring the huge pillars up to the king's chamber. I'm really not sure about that, but that was something that was suggested. This is what it looks like on the inside. People feel frequencies in there. Some people think that there were crystals in there or some other kinds of resonators. I really don't know. The king's chamber. So the frequency was brought up into through the gallery up into the king's chamber here. I just want to have you note one little detail. There were also two shafts going this way, but this one was unique in that it had a sort of a horn shape to it, which is one piece of evidence he claims that was part of a setup to create microwaves. So what was going on? They set up a frequency. The hydrogen was in the chamber, and it was, he says, speculates, that the king sarcophagus, which I'll show you a picture of that in a moment, was moved here between the two shafts, and it was concave on the inside of it slightly, and this is where it was resonated. I have a different interpretation of what was happening, and that the signaling, the microwave signaling, went out this way. Some people said it was going straight to the Orion belt, or went straight to a satellite. Well, that's all really speculative. And I'm not really sure what was happening there or how it was actually done. This would have been a filter chamber, but who knows? Anyway, that's what's proposed. Now, inside, we've got this sarcophagus, which is actually on the other end. I'm going to go ahead to this one. Here's an overview of where it was located. Here's the gallery the antechamber, the filtration, or they think, going in, here's where the shafts are. Dunn says that they moved it here, but who knows? Did they? Didn't they? It was set back here. And it was all in the middle of the pyramid, right? And this is what the pyramid looked like. It was built in situ. And there are 43 of these huge slabs that were 70 tons apiece. And there's space in between, and there's some holes in there, and it's speculated that each of these were tuned, okay? And the people who have done studies on this have concluded that the natural resonance in there was a resonance of the planet, 7.3 to 8.1 hertz. And that the musical tune of this was F sharp, and they've done studies on it. A guy named Tom Danley from NASA and also John Reed from Cymatics fame did studies of what was the resonance of that particular, they call it the sarcophagus here. What was happening is it was resonating in there, and I think the resonance was pinging these up here and sending it up to the top of the pyramid. That's my guess anyway. And I find it fascinating that the Egyptians also believed that the earth resonated at F sharp. So the coffer itself resonated at F sharp minor, and they say that these frequency differences created what was equivalent of a heartbeat. I thought that was pretty interesting. Now, my opinion, let's see, there we go, is that this might have been a static electricity accumulator. After all, the whole thing is of rose quartz. It's granite, 55% rose quartz. So you've got this whole structure in rose quartz, and all this static electricity and these compression waves going up toward the top, encased in this huge, monstrous, colossal structure that of 2.3 million blocks of limestone with all this silicon in it. Wow. So I think it was accumulating here, and then it would create a bubble, and it would go up, and it would ping the top, and it would keep on resonating, and it would keep on going up. That's what I think. And a fellow by the name of Willem Witteveen, who is a Dutch researcher, he wrote a book called The Secret of the Golden Frequency of Giza. He speculates and did some studies on this, and he concluded that it was, in fact, the Schumann resonance in there, and but it was at a second octave. It was actually higher than the first octave. So that's that one. We'll skip that. So we've pretty much gone through this. I believe that hydrogen was produced within the pyramid through mechanical means, and that a compression wave was built up from the subterranean chamber. The gas went up here. Later on, maybe it's been speculated that when this didn't work so well, they created more mechanical means of getting the hydrogen made and reacted in here. And that you can see that the roof here made of granite, it's going up to the Grand Gallery, and it's going up, whoops. Get rid of that. It's going on up into the King's Chamber and up through the pyramid to the top, where it is further amplified. Here's an interesting picture, a Carolean image of energy created with a Tesla coil. I think this is quartz, maybe it isn't. Tesla coil's in here, and look what it's doing. This is one of my Tesla Tech WebBot phrases, Birkeland currents. Now, one investigator pointed out, well, that was in the dark mode, we can't see them, but here in a Carolean photograph, here they are. In the Sumerian culture, here we have some pictures of them making pyramids. But what's interesting to me is, here's the pyramid, and here, this is a depiction of the electrical energy produced, Birkeland currents. I thought that was fascinating. And now we can go on to the natural magnetized energy of a pyramid. Got to go quick with this. There's about 100 volts that are accumulated as it goes up, until we've got about 14,600 volts at the top, okay? So that's one thing. That's just the natural current, let alone enhanced. What could they have created by the way they set up the pyramid? And here the pyramid shape itself enhances that. Here's the fire in the middle, created by just the configuration, the geometry of it. Interesting, isn't it? So what was it? Was it just a plain pyramid? Did it just create energies to attract lightning? Did it create negative ions just to enhance the inhabitants, to attract storms and lightning to the area for the agriculture? Did it, in fact, create microwave energy? Did it do more than that? Did it create the piezoelectric energy greatly enhanced that created Birkeland currents that went up into the ionosphere, connecting with the plate at the bottom, which was also experiencing compression waves on the opposite end? Should have mentioned that. So they have a top to bottom, right? They've got the plate and they've got the ionosphere. Were they creating energy this way? Was it in fact a giant crystal transducer? That's an open question. You be the judge. Now there's some details here. How am I doing on time? I'm okay. The Djed pillar. Was the Djed pillar just another smaller example of the king's chamber, a transmitter? This is called the Pillar of Osiris, also the Djed pillar. Usually with it is the buckle of Isis, which would be the receiver. So you've got positive and negative energy, which is shown here. Here's the positive energy, here's the receiver. This is the symbol of life, of course, and here's the electrical current. Over here, here's a similar setup. The circle would be the energy produced. Circle of life, perhaps, they thought. Some people said, oh, that's a Van de Graaff generator, maybe. And here's a Tesla harmonic oscillator. What do you think? And this I found fascinating. Here's another Djed pillar with it looks like a transmitter or amplifier up here. And then here's it is again with a receiver. And so you've got two of these. And now they're saying, let me read this. Between the Avenue of Sphinxes stood two generators, A and B. They're A and B. A ascending, B is receiving. And between them, it created a solitron or vortex field. And that field was used for moving heavy blocks. So maybe it was creating a field, an anti-gravity type of field. Dendera lights is another one. Now look up here at this contraption. This is found in the Temple of Hathor. Here you've got the Djed pillar, and you've got the receiver. Here again. And here you've got this curious little person with this little circle. And each one of these, what does that mean? This looks like a giant light bulb. Now, in each of these tombs and chambers, it's pitch black. There's no torch marks. There's no scorching, smudging, clean. They had to have had some form of illumination. This looks like, I don't know, some sort of transformer. This looks like a cord, right? And this looks like a giant, and this looks like a littler people. Could Titans have been living in those times, bigger people than are today? Here's another example of it. And guess what? It looks just like the cathode tube. Interestingly enough, that picture's been shown here before too. And Sir William Crookes was a very good friend of Tesla's, by the way. Some of you probably know that. And here we have the man. So let me get through this real quick, because a lot of you know all about Tesla. Tesla, I believe, knew about the pyramid effect from various places. Maybe his studies with Vivekananda, maybe hobnobbing with the elites of the day in New York, where surely at that time there was a lot of activity going on in the archaeology of antiquity and in Egypt. Maybe he learned something from people who were Masons, because the Masons are the ones that probably have learned whatever the Templars, the Greeks, and the Egyptian mystery schools had to offer. That was where it was handed down, whatever information we've gotten from antiquity. So here he was, and he started out with his first experiment of putting current through two plates at a distance, himself in the middle with a gas tube, discharge tube, and his audience was delighted. He started out that way. Then he made it bigger with his experiments in Colorado Springs. Here he discovered the terrestrial standing wave. Now he created these coils and transmitters, and he learned a lot from it. I'm not going to go into details. I've got them here, unless you have questions. You probably know all about it. What he created, though, was a resonance rise. He created a wave, an amplifying wave, from the plate of the Earth up into the ionosphere, which is what I think the Egyptians were also doing at the pyramid. And he created a lot of electricity that way. He kept experimenting. And then what did he do? Whoops. He does what I call supersized it. He did. He applied that effect to the Wardenclyffe Tower, only amplified it many, 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 many times. And so he's using the resonance rise of all of his coils. And that was at the very heart of his Wardenclyffe proposal. But there was this to it. I mean, he sunk a 300-foot iron rod down into the ground, and he did this over an aquifer, by the way, which led me to think maybe he knew something about how it was done at the pyramid. He was following that, and then he created all this current up into the ionosphere 80 miles above. Maybe it's kilometers, I'm not sure. Anyway, and this transmitting coil that he had, wow, what it could do. And he says, in this system that I have invented, it is necessary for the machine to get a grip of the Earth. Otherwise, it cannot shake the Earth. It has to grip so that the whole of this globe can quiver. That made me wonder a little bit. I mean, he's using the resonance rise of the continental plate here to help him create all this additional energy. And I wonder what would have happened if he'd have succeeded. Now, he did fire it up once, I'm told, and it went out about 26 miles. The effects of it went 26 miles. Of course, when he did his Colorado Springs one, he kind of blew the whole circuit system, the generators in the El Paso company was located there, and he had to fix it all up. So he was creating quite a lot of power. I just wonder what would have happened if it was a harmonic oscillator, what he would have done. And he was also tuning it to the Earth's frequency. Now I ask you, what would be the consequence of doing that if he was tuning this resonance rise and pinging and pounding the continental plate? What would have happened? You tell me. There's this wireless system that never got put into effect because J.P. Morgan and other unfortunate circumstances happened that it was never completed and was torn down, I believe, or dismantled in 1917. Too bad. And what I want to do, I'm getting close to the end, so bear with me, folks. I thought it would be interesting to compare the Great Pyramid with Wardenclyffe. So here are some commonalities. They both tapped into zero-point energy. They both were situated over an aquifer. They both had a subterranean ground in limestone. They resonated the Schumann cavity with the frequency of the Earth. And they both produced, I believe, the pyramid produced high voltage, okay? And they both connected with the ionosphere. I think their purpose was the same. I think they used pulsed amplification, but in different ways. And they were both harmonically tuned. Those are some very interesting correspondences, in my opinion. Further now, differences. The builders of the Great Pyramid used natural materials in situ, and they worked with them. They used the natural abilities of the quartz in particular. All right, and it was simple and elegant. Tesla used man-made materials, of course, but ultimately natural. The Egyptians used mechanical hydropulsing, and that's another buzzword. What did I put down here? Pumping or pulsing is all important in over-unity. AC current for pulsing, all right, in the Tesla coils. Cavitated hydrogen plasma used electromagnetic plasma, amplified by heat and pressure. Of course, if they were igniting or reacting the hydrogen, they were creating heat and pressure, which would only help to discharge the static or piezoelectric current that was in the natural rock, okay? He amplified with his Tesla coils. He had three different coils in there. Fine-tuned by resonators. I'm not sure how he fine-tuned it. I think he was fine-tuning with a magnifying transmitter. Maybe I'm wrong. You'll correct me. But what I like the most about it is that the Egyptians used natural harmonic processes. I put powerful harmonics here because I'm not sure if he was doing overload. The Egyptians were very careful about keeping it in harmony with the earth's resonance. And maybe they were very effective with that for centuries, because I think this went on for centuries, if not millennia. Whereas Wardenclyffe, well, he didn't have a chance to prove it one way or the other. What can we learn from this to enhance our current research and projects? Well, the first thing is expect the unexpected. I do want to give some credit to David Sarita with his theory of quantum harmonic oscillator. He studied pyramid codes. He's going to publish this. He thought it was a magnetic force field, faster than light speed communication with it, a stargate to other systems, our solar system, the greater universe, and finally as a tool for exploring inner as well as outer dimensions. I think that's true, and I agree with him a great deal, but I'm not going to talk about it extensively. And here he is. This will be coming forthcoming soon. And just when you may have thought I went too far, I do want to inform you that quite recently, NASA has discovered what they call X points or electron diffusion regions, and they're going to be studying these this year. These are portals of negative ions that connect the Earth and the Sun's magnetic fields. Here would be an example of this, right here in the negative ions connecting the Earth and the ionosphere. Here's an example of what the pyramids might have been able to do with their discharging of the piezoelectricity within the machine. And here's another example of Einstein-Rosenbridge, a wormhole. Could it have been used for anti-gravity purposes, for spacecraft going from the Earth planet to other parts? One wonders, but we'll look with interest to whatever the results of this research are. Tesla, again, it's all about energy, frequency, and vibration. And now, last year, this is next to the last, are we getting close? Next to the last, areas for further exploration and application. Last year, I pointed out it was important to build more leverage into the processes. I've heard about that today, especially with Stirling Allen. We're using several different processes to achieve over-unity and utilize ZPE. We can do more, and certainly the Egyptians did that. They used several techniques to make this happen. New and improved materials or substitutions. Yes, we're doing that. Well, I would propose this. Geopolymers, would that be interesting to work with? Use of sacred geometries and harmonics. The Egyptians used that all over the place. Are we exploring that a little bit? Maybe we could do more. Magnetic plasmas and fields. I think they did it. I think we're doing it, obviously, and making great progress. Element clusters. Obviously, water was all important. That's been emphasized throughout this conference. Cavitation in water. That's what I think they were doing in the subterranean chamber of the Great Pyramid. That's what we're doing, creating hydrogen. Noble gases, maybe they didn't do that in this instance, but that's something we're still working with. The use of light and sound. Certainly the Egyptians used acoustics to fine-tune their frequencies that they were using. Could we do more with this? Some people are working with it. So, I conclude that there is strong evidence that the Egyptians may have been accessing zero point and that we can learn something from them. I think the evidence is getting stronger all the time. They were pulsing the piezoelectric capacity within the pyramid, and they were doing this purposefully in many different kinds of ways, and they were pulsing it with compression or standing waves up into the very top of the pyramid where there was another amplification material, gold, crystal, whatever. For what purpose? That's for you to decide. But I think they were also using using cavitation, and it was very, very important for them to use until they could no longer use it and had to create hydrogen on their own. The importance of acoustics is obvious through their gallery and their king's chamber and the way they were pinging all of those granite columns. And finally, most important of all, I was so impressed with the fact that they were very conscious of working with the natural native frequencies of the planet so that they did no harm to it. So with that, I'd like to just say, as we investigate and learn more, we begin to learn more about them. And as we learn more about them in the cycle of things, we may just be rediscovering our own future. And with that, I'll say thank you so much for your time. Do we have
questions? We have questions, if you're ready to take some.
I can take some questions if we have time.
We have a question from someone who's very, very intelligent. I want to, he's going to ask you something. Mike?
Fire away.
John. My apologies, everyone. We have some questions. We have a question from someone who's very knowledgeable on the subject.
Good.
Can I put something up on the screen for him?
Sure.
Real quick. Come on, one more. There we go. Sorry, my tablet's a little bit touchy. One more. There we go.
Okay.
All right, come on.
Oh, you've got the Ankh there, the symbol of life. Oh, I bet you this is going to be a good one. That's a good one. What do you think?
Okay, my name is David Pukta. I'm going to give you some information from my, I have two companies. One of them is Proton Spin Technology, where we do research and development, manufacturing, and marketing of our products. My storefront is Hydrogen Injection Systems. I've done some interviews with Sterling, and this is a repeat of an interview with Sterling, and I'm going to try to validate exactly what she said from observations from my lab. This is not theory, okay?
Okay.
The question that I'm going to propose to you is that I'm going to take you outside of the pyramid for a minute. Mm-hmm. We know that the pyramid is producing a 1.9 megahertz frequency. Mm-hmm. The tube that goes up is 8 by 8.4, which is the attenuation of hydrogen. The blocked walls in there with the electrodes in them may have fired a hydrogen frequency attenuating around the Earth. In my lab and in my practice, we produce scalar waves that are reproducible on the scope, on my YouTube, for everybody to see exactly, you may call them Birkeland currents. We use those in our energy platforms. Mm-hmm. Okay, in that energy platform, we grow microbes to create biological oil or products. Mm-hmm. The microbes themselves, can you go back to the...
John?
The microbes themselves create 1.9 megahertz frequency standing, okay? So if they produce 1.9 megahertz frequency standing, then I'm going to propose to you that when he switches back the photo here, that this is what the ancient Egyptian Ankh was. It was an electrolytic cell resonating to 1.9 megahertz frequency. Mm-hmm. They put it in the Red Sea, washed the water through it. That's where I get my microbes from, salt water. Mm-hmm. Washed the water through it. Scalar waves are on point, resonating all the time. Mm-hmm. Could easily have grown electrolytic cell out of this, easily capped it off, and had a hydrogen flame that could burn in the loop and create energy. We've talked about the electric flame this whole time. Mm-hmm. And gave them their light, their energy, grew the algae for them pure so that they can eat that. And everybody knows about the monatomics and the fact that you've all seen the anomaly of fuel cells producing noble metals. Comes from the monatomic element, which comes from salt water, which comes from microbes that's reduced to gold. So now the Egyptians have gold, they have light, they have heat, nothing else but the practice of love.
Right. Thank you.
You're welcome.
I'm glad we've got that on tape. Thank you.
Are there any other questions for Suzanne Price? Oh, here she comes.
Oh.
We're almost out of tape. Here you go.
I'd like to add to all that truth, and I wanted to say that the correlations you made, perfect, except one more thing you forgot to add. All those two things, the pyramid connects to the Tesla coil, is also the human body. human body, mind, spirit.
True.
Human body, mind, spirit, etheric vessel that we are.
It is said that these energies enhanced agriculture and the well-being of the people in the area that the currents were able to generate too. So that certainly goes along with that as well.
Thank you very much, Suzanne Price.
Thank you.